Okay, everyone. So I guess time we begin. So good evening, everyone. I'm Mohammed Saad, one of the coordinators of Astronomy Club. And today we have gathered here to walk you through the starry field of astronomy. Don't worry, we assume zero background knowledge of astronomy from you all. So just sit back and relax and enjoy the session after your hopefully a bit tough MTH course. So from here on, the secretaries will take up. So, hope you enjoy.
Learning about our universe and how it works is more than just black holes and star clusters. It's about how science and technology allows us to study the world around us and rethink our place in it. It's about finding where we came from and whether there is life, even other universes out there. Oh, by the way, did I mention that this lecture ends with a 360 degree virtual tour of the universe? Come join us in this intergalactic journey.
These laws may have been ordained by God, but it seems that He does not intervene in the universe to break the law.
Just a second, I'll replay.
These laws may have been ordained by God, but it seems that He does not intervene in the universe to break the law. Outside, you can't tell what is inside a black hole. You can throw television sets, diamond rings, or even your worst enemies into a black hole, and all the black hole will remember is the total mass and the angular momentum and electric charge.
These stars, the high-mass ones among them, went unstable in their later years. They collapsed and then exploded, scattering their enriched guts across the galaxy. Guts made of carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and all the fundamental ingredients of life itself. These ingredients become part of gas clouds that condense, collapse, form the next generation of solar systems, stars with orbiting planets. And those planets now have the ingredients for life itself.
So astronomy puts you in place. Because of astronomy, we know that we are standing on a sphere of mostly molten rock and metal, which spreads 13,000 kilometers across with a fuzzy atmosphere about 100 kilometers high, surrounded by a magnetic field which is protecting us from the incoming subatomic particles from the sun 150 million kilometers away, which is also the flooding space with light that reaches across space to illuminate planets, asteroids, dust, and comets racing out past the Kuiper Belt through the Oort cloud into the interstellar space, past the nearest stars which orbit along the gas clouds and dust planes in a gigantic spiral galaxy we call the Milky Way, which has a supermassive black hole in its center, and it is surrounded by 150 globular clusters and halo of dark matter and dwarf galaxies, all of which can be seen by other galaxies in our local group, like the Andromeda and the Triangulum. And our group is on the outskirts of Virgo Galaxy Cluster, which is part of Virgo Supercluster, which is just part of many other gigantic structures that stretch most of the way across the visible universe, which is 90 billion light years across and expanding every day, even faster today than yesterday due to the mysterious dark energy. And all of this might be a part of an even large, infinitely large multiverse that extends both in time and space. So see, this is how astronomy puts you in place. But what exactly is astronomy? People often get confused in terms like astronomy, astrophysics, and cosmology. So astronomy is basically a branch of science that deals with the study of celestial objects, such as stars, planets, comets, galaxies. It's basically the study of everything in the universe that's beyond the Earth's atmosphere, also including the phenomena originating outside the Earth's atmosphere, such as the cosmic background radiation. So in short, it is the observation of celestial bodies. While astrophysics is the branch of astronomy that deals with the physics of the universe, including the physical properties of the celestial objects and also their interaction as well as their behavior. Cosmology is that discipline that deals with the nature of the universe as a whole. So cosmologists seek to understand the origin, the evolution, the structure, and the ultimate fate of the universe at large, and also the laws that keep them in order. Note that the term cosmonaut has nothing to do with cosmology. Cosmonaut indeed means a Russian astronaut. Then we have astrology. But what's astrology? Is it the same as astronomy? No, obviously not. It's just full of crap. It claims that the position of stars for some reason influences our moon. Let's get back to some real sciences. So for a long time, we humans had no idea as to what was going on in the universe. We made up stories which could help us explain what we saw. But then science came along and we began to understand more. We began to test our ideas, and this is how eventually the field of cosmology was born, right? So it was in 1912 that there was an astronomer named Vesto Slipher. He started taking spectra of spiral nebulae. Note that this was the time when galaxies were not known. When he examined those spectra, he saw that almost all of them were highly redshifted. In other words, it looked like most of the objects were rushing away from us at high speed, millions of kilometers per hour. But what could that mean? At this point, there was another Belgian physicist named Georges Lemaître. He had been studying Einstein's work at that time. So basically, Einstein had concluded that universe was static and unchanging. But Lemaître found that an expanding universe could fit the equation better. So given the redshifts which were observed by Slipher, he proposed that the universe was getting bigger, and that is why we observed that the galaxies appeared to be moving away from us. So this means that the universe is expanding. Wait, what? The universe is getting bigger? How can that be even possible? What does that even mean? So there are a lot of different ways of looking at this. Lemaitre himself suggested, imagine the cosmic clock running backwards. Right now, as time is marching on, all the galaxies in our sky, they are getting farther and farther away from us. But that means that at some point of time in the past, they were closer together. Run the clock back far enough and they get closer and closer together until at some point in the past, everything in the universe, literally everything, was crammed together in a single, unimaginably hot, dense thing. Then for some reason, it suddenly expanded violently and started cooling. This sounds like an awful, like an explosion, like a bang involving the entire universe, which is big. So what else would you call it but the Big Bang? There is the people often get confused that Big Bang was not actually an explosion. It did not involve an explosion in space, but actually it was an explosion of space. So all this is pretty strange, and astronomers also had a hard time accepting it. But at present, we have a lot of observational evidences which are in line with the Big Bang model. The universe does had a beginning and we can see evidence of it. Not only that, but by measuring how quickly it is expanding, we can use the maths to run the clock backwards and determine the age of the universe. Currently, the approximate age of universe is 13.8 billion years. Wow, that would require pretty large number of candles to be put on universe birthday cake.
So now we move on to our next section. Oh wait, why wasn't this slide deleted? To everyone attending this lecture, it's just a mistake and nothing mentioned here is true at all.
So, what astronomy club actually does? As the name suggests, the club aims to instill in the people an interest in astronomy and nurture the interest of those who are already awed by the subject's beauty. To achieve our aim, we organize activities all around the year. From observatory sessions to planetarium shows, we try our best to attract your attention towards the sky. To give a chance to people for showing off their skills and others to learn new skills, we conduct competitions which include spotting constellations, stars, Messier objects, solving cryptic puzzles, and solving astrophysics problems. For the ones who want to dig deeper in astronomy, we organize summer and winter camps each year with projects ranging from building an antenna to hunting exoplanets and asteroids, along with lecture series on various topics of astronomy and astrophysics. We conduct our annual Astrofest Mandakini, which sees applicants from different colleges putting their astronomy skills to the test to win the competitions and the prizes. Have anything to share or discuss? Visit the club and we will have a group discussion right beneath the stars like our forefathers. Now here I summarize the points which we conduct. Observatory for Astronomical Research. Astronomy Club IITK has built its own observatory for astronomical research. It hosts a mammoth 14-inch Celestron Edge HD, which brings the heavens down to Earth. The observatory was inaugurated in summer 14. It is currently open for observations. Next, we have planetarium shows. We are proud to have our own in-house planetarium built entirely by students and planetarium shows, some of which are made by the students themselves. The planetarium was inaugurated on January 29, 2012. And the next and the very important part is the astrophotography. To the uninitiated, nothing could be more logical than a focal photography. If you look through a telescope's eyepiece, why wouldn't you point a camera into it? The club has its own SLR camera, which is used for various photometrical projects. You will learn about astrophotography in detail in later slides.
You all must be curious to know what all telescopes does the club have. Before that, let's dive a bit into the theory of telescopes. A telescope is an optical instrument that uses lenses, curved mirrors, or their combination to observe distant objects. Firstly, coming to the refractor telescope. It is a type of optical telescope that uses a lens as its objective to form an image. Next, the reflector telescope. It is a telescope that uses a single or a combination of curved mirrors that reflect light and form an image. Finally, the catadioptric telescope. It can be understood as a combination of reflector and refractor telescope, which uses both lenses and mirrors to form an image. Coming on to Newtonian and Dobsonian telescopes, which are both reflecting telescopes. The Newtonian telescope was invented by Sir Isaac Newton. It uses a concave primary mirror and a flat diagonal secondary mirror. A Dobsonian telescope is an alt-azimuth mounted Newtonian telescope design popularized by John Dobson. It features a simplified mechanical design that is easy to manufacture. Both Newtonian and Dobsonian telescopes are quite popular among amateur astronomers. Now, let's get to know a bit about telescope mounts. A telescope mount is basically the telescope's support structure. They are broadly categorized based on the direction of movement and the coordinate systems, namely the ALTAZ, that is the altitude azimuthal, and RADEC, that is right ascension and declination system. Don't worry, we'll be covering this in the coming sections. Alt azimuth or the altitude azimuth mount allows telescopes to be moved in altitude up and down or azimuth side to side as separate motions. Next, the equatorial mount. The equatorial mount has a north-south polar axis tilted to be parallel to Earth's polar axis that allows the telescope to swing in an east-west arc, with a second axis perpendicular to that to allow the telescope to swing in the north-south arc. The club has got several Newtonian telescopes for astronomical observations. We have a Celestron 14-inch HSD with equatorial mount and a Celestron Astromaster 130EQ with equatorial mount. The observatory hosts a mammoth Celestron CGEM DX1400. Let's discuss the current hot topic now. You betcha, it's the James Webb Space Telescope. Any guesses for the final date on which the launch of JWST will settle? The Hubble Space Telescope.
25.
The Hubble Space Telescope was deployed in the 1990s. It's been nearly 30 years of its service, which will most probably extend to the 2030s. Succeeding it will be the James Webb Space Telescope, estimated to be 100 times more powerful than the Hubble Space Telescope. The telescope's main project is to investigate how galaxies formed and grew after the Big Bang, peering into the universe's depths to capture images of the first galaxies ever formed. Light from the first galaxies is still traveling to Earth, and Webb may spot it, of course, if at all launch occurs. The club has had a legacy of carrying out projects that relate to exploring new domains related to astronomy. A reflector telescope named Jumbo and a portable telescope was constructed by the club members back in 2012, along with a parallelogram binocular mount. Since then, we have explored several other interesting topics and domains in the form of summer projects, which the club conducts for students every year. Some of them include a mechanical star pointer, which automatically points towards the stars when coordinates are fed in it. The club also did a project on photometry, which helps in estimation of temperature, and spectroscopy, which helps in the estimation of radial velocity, which involved analyzing the data from our observatory. In summers of 2021, we did three major projects, beginning with computational astrophysics. Today, a major chunk of astronomical research involves analyzing huge data sets as well as simulating astrophysical processes. And thus, computational methods come in handy to an astronomer. The project built a foundation for computational astrophysics. We studied basic tools such as NumPy, Pandas, and AstroPy, and moved on to its implementation in time domain astronomy, image processing, spectral analysis, among others. The last few weeks are devoted to applying the techniques to analyze an astrophysical phenomenon or object. Next was the Final Frontier project. This project aimed to study the fundamentals of designing a space mission and to acknowledge the efforts made by space research organizations in designing and executing successful space programs. We understood the foundations of rocket design and propulsion systems, along with the dynamics and systems which keep things that we send to space in space. Lastly, we looked at the future of interstellar travel and what we must achieve before our goal becomes a reality. Finally, we had a RAD project, which is the Reading Analysis and Discussion project, which had won S&T Award for the best documentation in year 2020. The project aimed at understanding the universe and its intricacies, which is essential to do a proper study of different astrophysical objects and related phenomena. The project aimed to do the same from a theoretical astrophysics perspective. We tried to understand basic astronomy, such as how locations and distances are measured on the cosmic scale, and then see how Newton's two-body problem produces the path of the gigantic binary stars. The project also took a tour around stellar structure and galaxies, their types and formation. Towards the end, we tried to see how it all began, that is, the universe's birth.
Okay, so going back to planet Earth, let's start with the astrophotography part of astronomy. So astrophotography means exactly what you think it means. It means capturing photographs of any astronomical entity. A common myth is that, you know, you need a lot of expensive and heavy material.
Muted.
Hello?
Yeah, Aditya, you are audible.
Okay, cool. So, yeah, you can begin astrophotography with just a phone and, you know, a basic surface for placing it correctly so that it doesn't move that much. So, what all can you capture? So by just using a smartphone, you can capture amazing photos of star trails, constellation, and sometimes even the Milky Way. With advanced equipment, you can capture stars, planets, galaxies, nebulae, and a lot more. So what are the types of astrophotography? Firstly, we have the nightscape one. This beautiful image of the Milky Way and various constellations come under this category. It is one of the most popular types of astrophotography and is beginner friendly. So on a day with clear skies, you can do it simply with a smartphone in hand. Next up, we have the deep sky. This involves capturing objects such as nebulae, star clusters, and galaxies. This one requires time and patience, and you have to have heavier equipment for this. It also requires more post-processing, you know, to bring the most out of the image. This picture has several nebulae in it. The circular reddish one is called the Barnard's Loop. Horsehead Nebula and Witch's Head Nebula are also some of the examples that can be easily captured and spotted. Next up, we have the solar photography, which, as of course you guys know, is just the photography of the sun. It requires some special equipment and extra caution so that your eyes don't get burned and your equipments don't get fried, etc. So you have to proceed with proper caution. Next up, we have the lunar photography. Similar to the solar photography, this is a great place to start, you know, capturing the night sky, since moon is so beautiful and so easy to spot and is just out there for capturing using the telescopes and cameras, etc. Next up, we have the star trails. As we know, stars move in the sky. So when we take long exposure shots of the sky, we can actually see this movement in form of star trails. You can capture some very amazing photographs of star trails with just the smartphone and some apps for post-processing. And then there are some other photographs that you can click, like solar halo, lunar halo, etc. There are also celestial events that you can photograph, like solar and lunar eclipses. But you need to plan those beforehand. You need to capture images. You can even capture images of satellites transiting above you in the sky. For example, ISS on the moon, etc. Okay, so that was the types of photographs. Now, how do you go about capturing those? So basically, there are three steps involved in this. First of all, you need to plan what you are going to capture. For this, you need to do some research about the night sky. Find out the constellations that are visible. For example, some are visible during winters, some are visible during summers. Some are in upper hemisphere, some are in the southern hemisphere, etc. So you can use apps such as Stellarium to help you with this. Then you need to choose and gather the equipment that you will need to capture the image. Next, the actual shooting part. You have to set up the equipment and ensure that it is sturdy so that it doesn't move and you can capture the best of the photos. Ensure that the objects or the objects that you need, that you want to capture are in the frame and choose the setting of the camera correctly. For example, the aperture, the focal length, etc. There are a lot of other things also that you have to keep in mind, but for that we'll have a separate session as well. Now, the most important part, the post-processing. This is probably the most important. You need to do a lot of editing to make sure that the true beauty of the night sky can be seen in your photograph. For example, there are a lot of faint objects in the night sky, and to correctly see them, you need to do a lot of processing, such as color adjustment, sharpening, stacking of images, noise reduction, etc. And there are several softwares that can help you with this. If you are really into astrophotography, there are a lot of resources, even our own. For example, we had a workshop conducted. The link will be shared with you with these slides. We have a Drive link where you can get the guide of astrophotography that we have compiled for you guys. And we hope that this inspires you and you go out and click more shots of the night sky and show them in the astrophotography channel or a Discord server.
Now, we would like to showcase some of the beautiful shots from the Eyes on the Sky Astrophotography Challenge. All the clicks have been taken from your Y21 peers only. So, astrophotography is something which you can simply try using your mobile phone as well. And thus, we encourage you all to try to click astrophotographs under the night sky and flex them off at the astrophotography channel of our Discord server. Now, coming to something about which a lot of you are excited about, the solutions of riddles from Astro Treasure. Beginning with the first riddle. Away from the chaos, where the silence hits, and a sparkling paraboloidal entry of water sits. This is basically pointing out to the P.K. Kilka library, and thus the word library. The next lines, remove two letters from its tail, you will be left with a weighing scale. Basically, it is asking us to remove the letters R and Y, and after that you get Libra, which is the scale, weighing scale. The next lines read, the scale has a dear son who was once stolen by another one. So the son of Libra is basically Shubha, which was stolen by Scorpius, and thus Scorpius is being regarded as a thief. The thief was sent to kill a huntsman, putting an end to his lifespan. These lines talk about Scorpius being sent to kill the huntsman, which is the Orion. Yet another victim was part of the slaughter, the one who the huntsman had his eye on, killed by his daughter. This time around, it's being talked about Bellatrix, which killed Sirius. And you all guys must remember that there was a Harry Potter reference in the riddle, which basically relates to the killing of Sirius Black by Bellatrix Lestrange. Now coming on to the second Astro riddle. Welcome to the labyrinth, whose creator you just met, who made this riddle to prevent you from committing the same mistake his son did and enrage the Greek god. Here the Greek god being talked about is Daedalus, and his son's name is Icarus. But caring as he was, the god provided him with the elixir of life at a place you'll soon be familiar with. So basically, the place where the elixir of life or maybe the medicine is being provided is the Apollo Pharmacy, which is present at the campus of IIT Kanpur. And it was quite nice to see a lot of you got this answer by consulting your seniors. Near that was the residence of his queen, who was fascinated about the jewels in her catalogue. Unfortunately, the one that attracted her the most was caught up in a creature's tail. The queen being referred is the queen's residence being referred here is the girl's hostel, which is the Hall 6. Also, the jewels in the catalogue are being referred to the Messier 6, which is also abbreviated as M6. Also, if you will see the night sky or maybe in the Stellaria map, you'll be able to observe that the Scorpius constellation has the M6 located near the tail of the scorpion. Bard sang songs about misfortune, some people even claiming the creature to be a part of the Almighty's plan. Now this is the point where a lot of you got distracted or maybe got confused or did not get an idea what to say or what to guess. So that's why we provided a quite an appropriate hint to you, which was the meme of Drake. And at the end, the answer was actually Drake. So the God's Plan is basically a song, which is from the album Scorpion of singer Drake. And the last lines, but of the shadows came one person who proposed a solution to deal with the problem. What was the proposed solution? So finally, as you get the word Drake, you are able to figure out that the person's name is Frank Drake, and the equation whose solution is being proposed is the Drake equation. So we hope that you all enjoyed the Astro Treasure component of Eyes on the Skies competition.
Okay, so the most important thing while trying to understand the cosmos is using simulations. And one of the most famous apps for simulations is Stellarium. It's interesting. Why? Because it provides real-time rendering of the night sky, as well as accurate depiction of past and future events. And most of all, it's open source, so it's free, and you guys can also use it. But before we dive into that, we have to learn the coordinate systems. And there are two major accepted coordinate systems, the horizontal and the equatorial. So in the equatorial one, the North Pole is regarded as the pole star, that is the Polaris, whereas in the horizontal coordinate system, or the azimuthal one, the North Pole vector is the one that is normal to the plane where the telescope is being staged. So can you guys guess in this screenshot of Stellarium, which one is the North Pole of the equatorial and which one is that of the azimuthal? Can any of you guys guess?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, so you can see two poles right here. So which one is the equatorial North Pole and which one is the azimuthal North Pole?
Near Vega.
Near pole star is.
Okay, so let me give you some pointers. The upper one is which one and the lower one is which one?
Lower one is equatorial and upper one is horizontal.
Okay, are you sure?
Yes.
Okay, congratulations, you are right. Exactly, because this is the Polaris star, so obviously this has to be the equatorial North Pole, and naturally the other one will be the azimuthal or the horizontal North Pole. So moving on, the best part about the night sky, apart from the moon, of course, are the constellations. So what exactly are the constellations? So from the Google definition, or so to say, it's a group of stars forming a recognizable pattern in the sky. Well, you know, that's not exactly true. The proper scientific definition of a constellation is a region of space from which the sun is visible as seen from the Earth during the time of the year. So the night sky is divided into 12 major regions, which form the zodiacs, the 12 zodiacs that you guys know. Incidentally, those regions contain one major set of stars, which are also dubbed as constellations. So let's try to recognize a few. So we have, as you can see on the screen, we have four constellations. So can you guys recognize which one is which? Can you guys tell the name of the constellations?
Is Orion.
Okay. What about BCD?
Sage, Seven Star.
Big Dipper.
Which one? Big Dipper.
B. The fourth.
Ursa Minor.
Ursa Minor.
C.
C is Ursa Minor.
Okay. So the general consensus is A is what?
The Hunter. The Hunter.
Orion.
The Hunter. Okay.
Orion.
And
the Little Dipper.
Little Dipper, aka
Ursa Minor.
Okay. And C?
Seven Ashar, I think. I think C is Ursa Minor.
So then what will be B? If that's C, then what is B?
B Ursa Major.
B is Aries.
B is Aries?
Okay, we got one more guess for D as well. Somebody is saying D is Sagittarius.
Okay, so let me provide you guys with a hint. I have drawn the lines, so if that might help. So, are we reaching a general consensus on what either of these might be? You can write your answers in the chat as well, if due to some technical issues.
Write it now. After the next animation occurs, the answers will be in front of you.
Yep. So that's why I'm restraining from doing so.
He is Gemini, I think.
He is Gemini?
Or Leo?
B is Virgo.
Virgo.
Number B.
B is Virgo.
D is Pegasus.
Okay. We got
Leo.
We got B Ursa Major, D Saptarishi, and D Libra. Okay.
Okay. So
maybe now you can show the answers.
Okay. Let's reveal the answers. So let's guess them. So A is which one?
Orion.
Orion. Exactly.
Orion.
B is which one?
Ursa Minor.
Major. Ursa Major.
The bear is Ursa Major. And C part is?
Scorpio.
Yes, it's Scorpius. And D?
Cassiopeia.
Exactly. It's Cassiopeia. Congratulations. So let's move on. So the zodiacs. So just like Earth revolves around the sun also revolves around the galactic center of our Milky Way, that is Sagittarius A star, supermassive black hole. But unlike Earth, the motion of the sun is not exactly planar. Also, the plane of orbit of Earth and the plane of orbit of the sun around the Milky Way are not exactly parallel. They are at an angle of 60 degrees, as can be seen in this exaggerated illustration. So the motion of the sun in the Milky Way is kind of like a sinusoidal wave. And so when seen from the Earth, the sun appears to be going around these 12 different regions in the sky, in the night sky. And these 12 regions give us the 12 zodiacs that some of you might relate to astrology. But there is one error here. As you can see, near the Scorpius, the motion of the sun is much more into Ophiuchus in compared to Scorpius. And that's why some people believe that there are 13 zodiac signs instead of the normal 12. But anyways, the major takeaway from these two slides is that astronomy and astrology are two different words and hence two different things and should not be confused and should not be intertwined. All right. Okay. So moving on. That's enough of the theory. Let's move on to practical. Let's move on to the fun stuff. So for you guys, we have two demos of Stellarium lined up. First of all, we recently had the alignment of few planets a few weeks ago, Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, as well as Mercury. And also in 2012, we had the Venus transit, which will also be there in the year 2117. So without any further ado, let's move on to Stellarium. And by the way, you guys can even try it at home. It's open source. So is my screen visible? Stellarium screen?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, cool.
Yep.
So when you first, since it's the night sky, so nighttime, so it's showing the night time. So when you first start Stellarium, it will be something like this. So let me disable the atmosphere and the ground. So can you guys spot the four almost collinear planets from top to down?
Mm-hmm. Put your guesses in the chat box from top to bottom.
Yep. And let me tell you, this is real time. What you see is what you get in the real life as well as in the rendering. So can anybody spot the four planets? Obviously, this is the sun. So, any volunteers? The four almost collinear planets. Do we have a response?
I can see.
Yeah, we have one response. It's Saturn, Neptune, Jupiter, and Venus.
Okay, so someone else was also speaking. I think he or she may have got cut off. we encourage you to participate in these things, as you know, it gives us a great time and it provides you with a great time as well. So can you guys recognize the four planets?
We have Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, Mercury.
Okay, from bottom to top, top to bottom, left to right, right to left.
Yeah, from top to bottom.
Top to bottom.
Okay, so let me clear it for you guys. So that's Jupiter, that's Saturn, that's Venus, and that's Mercury. So as I said, they were in the alignment a couple of weeks back, and since then they have changed their position. Okay, so this is about the alignment of planets, and next we'll see the Venus transit of Sun in the year 2117. So let me just select Venus and put it in focus. Next, let me set the year. This will take just a moment. And I know it is happening on 11th December, so I can set the date accordingly. And it will happen at almost 4:30 in the morning, GMT, by the way. It is not the Indian Standard Time. This is the GMT. So as you can see, Venus is terribly close to the Sun right now. So, okay, it's in frame. And all right, let's start the simulation. So I have fast forward the simulation. As you can see, Venus is currently in front of the Sun as the dark spot, as the dark black spot you can see, and it is almost going on a straight line in front of the Sun as seen from the Earth. So this is the Venus transit that will happen in the year 2117 on December 11th. You guys can even try it out on after this presentation ends. So that was the transit. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. And okay, so now a major drawback of Stellarium is that we can use this app only to render things that happened in the past or that are currently happening or that can happen in the future. But say, if you want to see, like, I don't know, Rigel and a black hole collide, two black holes collide, or even Saturn going, an asteroid or comet hitting Saturn, you can't simulate it in that, right? So for that, we have another app called Universe Sandbox. So I invite Prasanth.
As others showed us, we can find real-time phenomena happening around us using Stellarium simulator. Universal Sandbox is another great physics-based space simulator. This simulator will help you find solution to your what-if questions. Questions like, what if two black holes collide? What if two suns collide? Also, any imaginary thing, like what if Earth had a Saturn ring and collided with a black hole? Sounds funny, right? Now we will see some simulations done on Universal Sandbox that I did to find solution to my what if questions. As you can see, here is a massive star known as Rigel and a supermassive black hole. There are four types of black holes: stellar, intermediate, supermassive, and miniature. Here we have a supermassive black hole. As you can see, Rigel is getting attracted towards the black hole. In the final stage, the enormous star goes out with a bang. Here we have another simulation with a Saturn and two black holes, intermediate black holes. At approx 60 degrees, with one black hole much nearer to the Saturn. Now we can see Saturn ring. Saturn ring is being swallowed by the black hole too. And later, the Saturn itself. Now the two black holes go on to combine and form a bigger black hole. Here you can see they are going towards each other. They combined and formed a bigger black hole. If you hit any planet, you can also launch asteroid or any planet towards it. Here we have a simulation of our asteroid heading towards our Earth. As we saw, we can create, destroy, and interact on a scale never imagined before and do wonders on Universal Sandbox. Now I will pass on to Sai Krishna to carry on the journey to astronomy. Hope you guys enjoyed it.
Hello, everybody. I'm going to talk about astronomical events. A lot of events occur simultaneously in space, but we cannot observe everything because we are limited by our technology, and also the universe is very large. So let's discuss some events and gain some useful information. Why is observing astronomical events so important? It is important because the motions of astronomical objects determine specific phenomena like the day-night cycle, seasons of the year, timing of eclipses, and visibility of comets and meteor showers. Now, we will look at some basic astronomical terminologies. We'll first look at comets. A comet is an icy, small solar body that, when passing close to the sun, warms and begins to release gases. These phenomena are due to the effects of solar radiation and the solar wind acting upon the nucleus of the comet. In the solar system, comets originate from a region called the Oort cloud, which is beyond Pluto. The properties of comets are sufficiently bright enough to be seen by the naked eye, and they revolve in an elliptical orbit around the sun. Next, we look at asteroids. Asteroids are small, rocky objects that orbit the sun, and most of them are situated in the asteroid belt, but some of them are located away from the asteroid belt. The asteroids which are located near Earth are called the near-Earth asteroids. Now we'll move on to meteoroids and its kinds. Meteoroids are objects in space that range in size from dust grains to small asteroids. When meteoroids enter the Earth's atmosphere at high speed and burn up, they are called meteors. These are also called as shooting stars. Its weight is estimated to be as high as 50 tons. When a meteor hits the Earth, it is called a meteorite. Now we look at some astronomical events. We'll first look at the transit of Venus. When Venus travels between the Sun and the Earth, it is called the transit of Venus, which results in a view that shows Venus as a black disk with the Sun in the background. It occurs in a pattern which generally repeats every 243 years. It was last seen in 2012, and it will occur again in 2117. Even though Venus's diameter is three times the size of the Moon, it appears smaller due to being further away from the Earth.
Now I will discuss another interesting astronomical event, meteor showers. Geminid meteor showers. The Geminid usually put on a dazzling display that wows sky watchers around the world each December. NASA says astronomers consider it one of the best and most reliable showers of the year, but the shower actually did not start occurring until very recently in astronomical and human terms. First reports of the shower emerged in the mid-1800s, but at the time there were only 10 to 20 meteor showers per hour. These days, it's more like 120 meteors at the peak. Leonids. The shower is called Leonids because it's radiant, or the point in the sky where the meteor seems to emerge from, lies in the constellation Leo. In 1833, meteor showers were so intense, 1 lakh meteors in an hour, and they were referred as meteor storms, as you can also see in the image present alongside. The Leonid meteor storm titled The Night the Stars Fell. Next, we have the diamond ring effect. The diamond ring effect occurs at the beginning and end of totality. The state or period of an eclipsed body is totally hidden during a total solar eclipse. As the last bits of sunlight pass through the valleys on the moon's limb, edge of the visible surface of the moon as viewed from the Earth, and the faint corona, sun's lower atmosphere, around the sun is just becoming visible. It looks like a ring with glittering diamonds on it, and it's the most lovely sight, which typically lasts a seconds or so. Next, most of you must have heard of it, Halley's Comet, a rare visitor. Orbiting around the sun every 75 years, Halley's Comet is a periodic comet that was named after Edmund Halley in 1531 when it was discovered. Following an elliptical orbit, its closest approach is 46 million miles to the sun, which illuminates the comet while it makes its trip through the solar system. Visible from a variety of locations on Earth with the naked eye, it has a length of 9 miles and a width of 5 miles. It was last seen in 1986, and it will be seen again after 76 years. Now we move to a fun fact. Many of you might be already knowing this. That the 8 major planets of our solar system can never come into perfect alignment. This is because of the orientation and tilt of the orbits of the planets. The last time the planets appeared in the same part of the sky was around 1,000 years ago in the year AD 949.
Do we have ancient aliens fans here? Looking at this picture, I think some of you might have guessed which section we are headed towards. If not yet, let's go to the next slide. Ever heard of Area 51? No, I'm not interested in talking about the secret activities that used to take place there. I'm talking about the big joke from 2019, which involved planning and advertising to storm Area 51, which gained so much attention worldwide and ended up being a blooper. The people could not storm Area 51 at the end. But don't worry, we have an Area 52 for you all on our Discord server, and feel free to storm it. On the internet, we need to be skeptical reader these days. Claims of aliens and UFOs, Mars being abnormally big, or the moon turning green are kinds of things we should check out carefully. Here are some of the biggest space myths that just won't go away. Okay, so the Apollo moon landings. Before anything else, we want to know how many of you believe that those were fake. Feel free to express your thoughts in the chat. In the decades since Apollo 11 astronauts first set foot on moon, many theories have been put forward claiming that the whole Apollo program was staged. Some questions that came up were, why were there no stars in the sky in the moonwalkers' photos? Why are the US flags fluttering on the surface? Why do you see footprints in the pictures, but no marks on the lunar modules that landed there? The next theory is that Saturn's hexagon being an alien technology. Saturn's hexagon was first spotted when NASA's Voyager spacecraft flew by the giant ring planet in 1980. The bizarre six-sided structure on the round planet's north pole caused quite the stir because straight lines and polygons are not so common in nature. Immediately after the Voyager return, its first images of Saturn's strange feature, even stranger theories arose to explain it, including that it was somehow related to alien technology, or perhaps even was a gateway to hell. The hexagon is not artificial, but rather a weird-looking hurricane that at Saturn's pole. NASA has done several flybys of this region with the Cassini spacecraft, studying the haze particles and other features of the storm and to try to learn more about its weird properties. Finally, the multiverse theory makes an appearance as if it were customary to have it in a lecture themed on astronomy. Multiverse theory suggests that our universe, with all its hundreds of billions of galaxies and almost countless stars spanning tens of billions of light years, may not be the only one. Instead, there may be an entirely different universe, distantly separated from ours, and another and another. Indeed, there may be an infinity of universes, all with their own laws of physics, their own collection of stars and galaxies, and maybe even their own intelligent civilizations. The universe is full of both verified and hypothesized objects that do not fit neatly into the humdrum world of standard classes of planets, moons, galaxies, and well-understood phenomena. So, here are some extreme deep space astronomical objects that have either been discovered or may well exist out there somewhere among the stars. First, we have the antimatter fountain. The antimatter reaction is the ultimate inefficiency. If we have 1 gram of matter and 1 gram of antimatter and put them together, they will violently annihilate each other in a 100% conversion of mass into energy. But there is a rabbit hole here. There is no clear reason as to why Big Bang wouldn't have produced equal amounts of matter and antimatter. But for some reason, not yet understood, it seems that slightly more matter was created than antimatter, allowing for the universe's matter to exist today as we see it. But antimatter can still be created even in nature. Within the center of the galaxy, an unseen antimatter fountain spews thick geysers of positrons thousands of light years above the galactic plane, which then go on to annihilate on contact with normal matter. The observed antimatter positrons could be produced by black holes, neutron stars, or gamma ray bursts. Scientists using data from an instrument on NASA Compton Gamma Ray Observatory have discovered 2 unexpected clouds of antimatter in the Milky Way galaxy, which scientists call antimatter annihilation radiation. Next, we have the double quasar. It is a kind of 2-for-1 punch in strangeness, not only because of the nature of what it is, but also because of the strange occurrence associated with it that was caught entirely by pure chance. It was discovered in 1979. Initially, it appeared to be 2 quasars located very close to each other, something that seemed quite unlikely. As study of the object progressed, it was realized that the 2 quasars were so similar that they would essentially have to be twins, making the whole thing even more unlikely. Later, instead of being 2 quasars, it was found that they were actually 2 images of the same quasar that were being gravitationally lensed by a galaxy in the foreground. This was one of the first gravitationally lensed objects ever found, and confirms Einstein's view of space-time being warped and capable of lensing objects. There is an interesting effect in this case. Any change in the quasar is seen in one image, but because the other image represents a slightly different path, the same change is not seen in the other image for over a year later. This quasar also happens to be extremely distant at 7.8 billion light years, and the galaxy that is in front just over half that. Seriously gives goosebumps listening to something like this, isn't it? Next, we have the Einstein cross. It is a gravitationally lensed quasar. While gravitationally lensed light sources are often shaped into an Einstein ring, due to the elongated shape of the lensing galaxy and the quasar being off-center, the images form a peculiar cross shape instead. Looking at its image, we would like you to guess how many objects are present in it. Any guesses?
Single up.
3.
2. 1.
1.
And
just 1 object.
9. 1 object.
5.
We have quite a lot of 1 in the chats as well.
Okay, I see. One is quite like attracts attention a lot, isn't it? Any other?
We have a 3.
Okay.
We even have a 5.
Oh, we have finally got a 5. Nice.
Yeah. We would like to remind you guys that this is not
I think
bidding.
4 is the correct. After reflexion, 5 is also created. Automatically created. 4 is the right answer.
Who is do you know the reason, like any reasoning for your answer?
Yes, maybe in reflection, wagera kuch hota hoga, uske wajah se chautha panchma ban gaya isse.
Like, you are really correct. The correct answer is indeed 4. So basically, the Einstein's cross has 4 objects, 2 of which are galaxies, and the 2 of them are quasars. Now, I have another quick question for you all. Do you know what is the coldest place in the universe Oh, come on. We are just curious to know your astrology and guessing ability, not your Googling skills. Give it a try.
Region of said observability.
Earth's lab.
I guess black holes are the coldest.
Cryogenic lab.
Yes, labs. Labs on Earth.
Natural. Natural, of course.
I think Neptunus.
Space
between space
between galaxies.
Empty space.
It is quite a specific answer. Does anyone know about that?
Neutron star.
Do we have any guesses in the chat?
Well, I guess there is a great void in the universe. I have heard about it. It's the coldest.
Just a hint for all of you. It's named after a throwing object, if that makes any sense.
You play with it. Even more hints.
I mean, it has a specific name, not just neutron star or black hole. It has a proper name.
Frisbee.
Okay, we have one example, one answer, boomerang. But boomerang what? I mean, boomerang star.
Boomerang planet. What is it?
Boomerang planet. I mean, Earth can be
the question again.
Coldest place in the universe.
Boomerang Nebula.
Yeah, indeed. Boomerang Nebula is indeed the correct answer. So, the Boomerang Nebula is a protoplanetary nebula located 5,000 light years away from Earth in the constellation Centaurus. It is also known as the Bowtie Nebula. The nebula's temperature is measured at 1 Kelvin, making it the coolest natural place currently known in the universe. Don't worry, it wasn't just about the lecture. We have some more things lined up for you all. Here is a teaser for the club's Cygnus magazine, for which a lot of hard work has been put up by the secretaries and coordinators of the club. We'll be releasing it pretty soon. I'm sure you'll enjoy reading it. We also have Don't Look Up movie stream planned on 25th December. All details related to it would be conveyed via the club's Discord server. Hurry up if you haven't joined the server yet. Make sure you join it right now. You'll find a link in the chat. That's all for the introductory lecture. I hope you all enjoyed it. Looking forward to see you guys participate in large numbers in future events of the club. Thanks a lot for being such a great audience. Cosmos is within us. We are now open for your questions. Feel free to unmute or ask via chat.
I have a doubt. How can we access universe sandbox?
Go ahead. After that, please raise your hand so it would be better. Go ahead, Satyam. You can go ahead.
मुझे पूछना था नेबुला ठंडा कैसे हो सकता है वहां तो स्टार वगैरह बनते हैं तो
सो बेसिकली इसका रीजन एक होता है कि नेबुला जो तुमको अभी दिख रहा है वैसे वो द स्केल इज क्वाइट लार्ज इट एक्सटेंड्स अप टू लाइट इयर्स एंड यू नो द जो वहां पे जो डेंसिटी होती है अगर तुम लोकल डेंसिटी पे जाओगे वो बहुत कम होती है तो ऑफ कोर्स वहां स्टार्स बनते हैं बट स्टार बनने में जब क्या कहते हैं जब स्टार बनना शुरू होता है तो सारे जो भी पार्टिकल गैसेस वो सब क्लोज आ रहे हो जब क्लोज आते हैं जब डेंसिटी बढ़ती है तब वहाँ पे टेम्परेचर बढ़ता है और फिर मेजर टेम्परेचर राइज तब आता है जब फ्यूजन शुरू हो लेकिन जब तक वो सब नहीं होता मतलब तुम समझ लो एक बस गैस क्लाउड है स्पेस में जो कि काफी डिस्टेंस पे है एंड देयर इज नो सनलाइट और एनी काइंड ऑफ हीट रीचिंग दैट प्लेस तो इसलिए टेम्परेचर बहुत कम होता है
मैंने सुना था कि कहीं मतलब जब भी ऐसे स्टार्स मिलते हैं तो एक स्टीफन रेडिएशन से वो टेम्परेचर लो होता रहता है उसी हिसाब से
दैट इज अ टर्म गिवन टू दैट थिंग रादर देन
हॉकिंग रेडिएशन
हॉकिंग रेडिएशन ब्लैक होल से
रिलेटेड
सो इट इज नॉट रिलेटेड
टू द स्टार
एक्चुअली नॉट गोइंग ऑन सो हाई फाई टर्म्स वी ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड इट इन द बेसिक टर्मिनोलॉजीज
By the way, अगर ये चीज डिटेल में पढ़नी हो, I can suggest a course. Yeah. It's 5667. But हाँ, nebula या फिर like जहाँ से stellar formation शुरू होता है, that's called even giant molecular clouds. But main reason ये होता है कि वो gas cloud इतने large scale पे होते हैं, and the local density is so less. तो और क्या कहते हैं, जो external sunlight नहीं कहूँगा, जो भी starlight है, starlight is the source of heat at those places mainly. तो वो हीट मतलब वो पेनिट्रेट नहीं कर पाती है सो दैट्स व्हाई दीज रीजन्स आर कोल्ड बट जैसे जैसे ये क्या कहते हैं ग्रेविटेशन, जैसे ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स ओवरकम होती है क्या कहते हैं इंटरनल प्रेशर को, तो ये कोलैप्स करना शुरू करते हैं। जैसे कोलैप्स करना शुरू करते हैं क्या कहते हैं द पार्टिकल्स कम क्लोजर, दे स्टार्ट कोलाइडिंग, तो फिर वहां से हीट हो जाता है एंड वंस टेम्परेचर इतना पहुंच जाए कि क्या होता है कोलैप्स होके कोर बनता है, और कोर का जब टेम्परेचर इतना पहुंच जाता है कि न्यूक्लियर फ्यूजन स्टार्ट हो, तब हम कहते हैं द स्टार हैज टेकन बर्थ। सो अगर फ्यूजन नहीं स्टार्ट होता है वी डोंट से कि स्टार हैज टेकन बर्थ। तो जनरली स्टार्टिंग में टेम्परेचर लो ही होता है, इवन आई वॉज शॉक्ड, मैंने कोर्स में पढ़ा था तो मुझे फिर पता चला अच्छा ठीक है, मतलब नेब्यूला या जायंट मॉलिकुलर क्लाउड्स उनकी यही आता है कि उनका टेम्परेचर हाई होगा लाइक 1000 केल्विन और समथिंग, बट नहीं नॉर्मली ऐसे 50-60 केल्विन या 100 केल्विन। बूमरैंग नेब्यूला गोज इवन लोअर अप टू 1 केल्विन। सो अगर और डिस्कस करना हो तो पिंग मी एनी टाइम, सर्वर पे पिंग कर देना।
सो वी हैव हिमांशु, हिमांशु इज हैंड ओवर देयर। सो हिमांशु
हेलो।
या
नहीं, आई हैव अ डाउट दैट हाउ कैन वी एक्सेस यूनिवर्स सैंडबॉक्स।
Actually, we are planning to have, basically we are planning to have that from our club's ID, and as soon as we get it, the interested people can come to the club, and one by one we can have the access. So that till that time you need to wait.
Okay, and I also tried to shoot the stars in the sky in the dark night. So yeah. Read the astro by photography guide, and I don't have that much ISO and exposure. So how can I take that star trail?
So Saad would be better one to answer this question.
Himanshu, you can text me anytime with the specs of your phone. I'll suggest something.
Okay, and one more thing. How is eclipses and transits calculated?
Sorry. Okay. So you are asking about what eclipses, right?
And transits, Venus okay. transits, etc.
So actually, we have one question in our Mandakini, in just previous year Mandakini, and it was basically it was on the same lines. How we are calculating about the transits and all. So I guess for matlab you have to basically take two references, one guy from the North Pole and the other one from the South Pole. Observing the same transit, basically the time differences that you get, just measure those time difference, and from that particular time difference you will get some omega and all. So that will particularly leads towards guessing certain time, like after what duration you might experience the transit, or what is the particular duration transit happened. So I guess you can link it somewhere here. If I'm not very clear now, you can DM me of course. So,
okay.
Is it okay, Himanshu?
Yes.
Yeah, cool. We have Atulya.
Do you like which course did you suggest? Like, if I wanted to study the actual physics of
Saad, could you please answer?
Yeah, I'll put it in the chat. It's a PG level course, but you can take it in your second year. Doesn't assume much prerequisites.
Yeah. Okay, like IITK itself.
Yeah. It's offered by the physics department. Actually, I am from the physics department, so that's why I took energy stuff.
So now we can move to Abhinav.
Good evening. I wanted to ask that will you suggest any good books or kind of things for this knowledge?
For knowing more about astrophysics. Books.
Yeah, kind of.
So just need not to worry about the terms that we used in the entire lecture and all. Just take it in the lower sense and like just enjoy it. Just enjoy it. And in slowly manner, you will able to basically grasp the thing. So and if you are wondering about like for what book you should start with and all to know about this astrophysics. So basically we had one summer project this year and in our previous year as well, we refer Frank Shu's book. Actually, that is a very good start for astrophysics and getting some basic ideas about how the nebulas do form and all, getting into those stuffs. So I guess you can refer that. We have GitHub link of the same as well. I guess Techies would direct you to that. So yeah, you can refer from there.
You can even go on the website, and
yeah,
for the RAD project, we prepared a handbook. So basically it's the concise form of those 2-3 books combined. So you can refer to that handbook. But if you need a further proper text, published textbook, so as Sunny suggested, Frank Shoes, A Physical Universe. And there's an introduction to astrophysics by Carroll and Ostley. These two are the standard books.
Please repeat the names, please. Okay. Someone sent it, right? Thank you.
Gurbaz has attached it. It's there in the RAD handbook. So first you can go through the handbook. It's quite concise. And after that, we have mentioned the references there as well. So you can see those references. The two books are in the references. You can find the handbook in the club website. It's also linked there in the chat.
So I guess we have answered your question, Abhi, right?
I think I would just add to it. So if you guys want a book that's not mathematically intensive, there's a book by Neil deGrasse Tyson, Astrophysics for People in a Hurry. I think you could refer to that as well. It's not mathematically intensive, so it could be just a casual read.
Goes Without Saying Cosmos is a great series.
Cosmos by Carl Sagan.
I have heard about that.
So those who are not into reading, it's a good.
Himanshu, you have more.
One more doubt I have, that in the space missions which you are suggesting, sir, any simulation here also?
Particularly in the space mission, the space project that you are being targeting, right?
Yes.
Okay. So in that particular project, we basically tried to know basic introductory of rocketry. And after getting deep dive into it, like how does rocketry works and like what all steps do take place for handling a certain space mission, we actually covered certain model and all. And basically, we have covered into the interior about it. I mean, like we had covered some trajectory optimization and something like that. So for getting more info about that, just I will suggest you to go to the YouTube channel and you can find it there. Also, it is present in the GitHub repo. So why don't you go to the GitHub link and
We also used Kerbal Space Program to design our own space missions for that.
I was also trying to get Kerbal Space Program, but I couldn't get it.
Just connect with us and we could.
Approach us, we can provide you with that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Link for that YouTube channel is there. If anybody can't, and GitHub repo as well.
Next we have Ritik. Go ahead, Ritik.
Yeah, good evening.
I
was asking how much physics are we going to be taught in this club?
Literally, you had taken very opposite manner. This club is basically meant for just introduction to astronomy, right? And we will teach you, or we will guide you basically very basic concepts. So just need not to worry about such terms and all. And literally doesn't matter how much physics you know and all. It's basically just J level physics and all. It doesn't are even a higher class physics at the introductory level. But as soon as you will get some basic concepts clear, you can obviously move towards higher concepts.
So I think astronomy is a very interdisciplinary field, and there are stuff involved apart from physics. Like if you just take a look at us four cordies, so only two of us are from physics department. Sunny is from chemical and Gurbaz is from CSA department. So you can take a guess. There's obviously a bit of coding involved as well. And if you are making telescopes, there's a lot of instrumentation and electronics involved. It's a very interdisciplinary field, and there's a lot of stuff apart from physics. And
you can explore basically anything you would like, and it, as long as it's astronomy themed.
Even matlab, I can say each and every branch is involved in a very interesting manner into it. Like if we are talking about the propulsion systems and all, so basically the designs of the pumps and all. So it somewhere comes about in the domain of mechanical engineers or something, chemical engineers who used to do these things. So it's basically a very inbuilt things, and like each and every branch is very, very, very much involved into it. So need not to worry how much physics you know and all. We will just teach you that. Basically guide you, not teach you.
Yeah, and I had one more query.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was like you referred to Astrophysics for People in a Hurry book, yeah, by Neil deGrasse Tyson. Okay. So I tried to read it, but I found out that book was more of it was into cosmology rather than astronomy.
Which particular book? Frank Shu?
No, I think he was talking about Neil deGrasse Astrophysics for People in a Hurry by Neil deGrasse Tyson. I think you could maybe refer to Cosmos by Carl Sagan if you feel that it's the other book is more towards Cosmos. I mean, there's not a very specific book for astrophysics. Like, if you are interested in a particular topic, like you could, I think you would read review papers as such.
Mm-hmm. But whenever you talk about astrophysics, then there is a bit of math involved, so it becomes complex.
Ritik, are you comfortable with the physics and proper math, like studying it proper way, or you want just
yeah.
Just go ahead with either Frank Shu or Carol and Ostley. They are the best resources if you are fine, if you really want to study it along with the equations, you know.
And to tackle that, you lie your interest in astronomy, we have planned certainly some cool things like mini projects aligned. So just take them and like properly do that. You will find a very much deep interest in astronomy, and you'll basically link how physics, mathematics, and how different fields are aligned. So yeah,
I think there's also a really good website called AstroBytes. So it's basically they do reviews of papers, recent research papers, and they dumb it down to like a layman's level, so you could refer to it as well. You could like read through like recent happenings in the field of astronomy, basically anything that's remotely related to astronomy, and it's dumbed down to our level, so you could refer to it as well. I'll just paste the link in the Gurbaz has already.
Yeah, and can you repeat that name, the second book?
An Introduction to Astrophysics by Carol and Ostley.
Okay, and just one more query.
Huh? Okay.
I shouldn't ask this probably, but like the Universe Sandbox, how did you get it?
Actually, I answered this query earlier as well, right? So we have some accounts, and we will have more after you guys reach on to campus. So like you can also enjoy it.
So like I think you could either pirate it, but we wouldn't recommend doing it. Yeah. If you could wait for a while till you come back to campus, we are buying the official subscriptions for Universe Sandbox 2 and a few other astronomy based softwares, and if you like get in touch with us, we would provide you with a official copy.
Do we also have Stellar Engine?
No. I don't think we have that, but
Space Engine.
Space Engine, we do.
I think we are familiar with the software, but we do not have the official copy yet.
I have downloaded it, but it doesn't work in my computer.
Yeah, it is a heavy app, and like it also like features gravitational time dilation, like near. Like
it was very interesting.
You'll need an upgrade for
particular installation issues. Just ping either of we coordinators. We would direct you to the person who is better.
Put it on the server.
Yeah, just
the concerned person will just report back to you.
Also, like you said, like for KSP, what do we do?
For KSP, what do we do? I mean, what particularly?
Like, I mean, like if we wanted to play, like.
Okay.
I have an alternate in orbital spaceflight simulator. Of that.
I'm not sure what Himanshu is doing.
As KSP is paid, so I have downloaded another, that is orbital spaceflight simulator. It is also great.
Great. So, Himanshu, you will teach us definitely, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
More queries to go? Okay, then if you have any queries left, just ping to either of our coordinators or some secretaries over there. Just ping them, they will direct you to the right person. And also you can write in Discord server. So just
hello, I want to
go there and write your questions.
Uh-huh. Yeah, go ahead, whoever
is. I wanted to know ki ko matlab hum aisa kya kare so that we can call ourselves as a part of this club.
Nothing.
Okay, nothing.
So basically like jo bhi hum events karaye just take part in that. So basically everyone at IITK is, you can say, like there's no concept of membership of a club. So you just freely take part in the events.
No, either ways you can take, you know, 999 membership subscription. We are happy with it.
Go ahead.
And second thing, if any one of us come up with a good idea of, you know, astronomy or something,
uh-huh.
So iske kya steps hote hai, matlab?
Just share it with us. Share it with us. That's the direct step.
The Discord server is for that, for discussions and all.
Okay.
Check out the Discord server. There are several channels where if you find something interesting, put the link up there, then interested people will strike up a discussion for sure.
Yeah. Fine.
I guess so. That's it for the day. Those who are waiting for their dinner, I guess they already left. So others may also leave. Secretaries, please stay here, and others, please leave. Thank you for coming to the session.
Thank you.
It was awesome.
Thanks.
Thanks.
It was awesome.